This is the holy Sabbath day. Why is it so special? It's written in Exodus 31. Exodus chapter 31, and there in verse 13. Speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, Verily, my Sabbaths you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you. In the Ten Commandments, it is identified as the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. And this is a sign of a relationship. Because what does it say here? It is a sign between me and you. He is introducing a relationship concept. And I want you to know that I am your Lord that is at work for your sanctification. And who is this Lord that is saying, I want a relationship with you, which the Sabbath is a sign of? If you turn to Mark chapter 2, verse 27 and 28. Mark chapter 2, verses 27 and 28. And he said unto them, The Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. Who is the Lord that sanctifies us? That the Sabbath is a sign of? Jesus Christ. He said, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. The Sabbath made for man. A sign and an integrated exercise of sanctification, of which Jesus is the active agent to sanctify us, and therefore he is the Lord of my life and the Lord of the Sabbath. Let us read Hebrews chapter 2, verses 9 to 13. Hebrews 2, the Lord of the Sabbath. The Lord of our sanctification. Hebrews 2, reading from verses 9 to 13. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that by the grace of God should taste death for every man. For it became him for whom are all things and by whom
are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation. Don't you love the language? He is the captain of your salvation. How does he become the captain of our salvation? To make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. For both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one. For which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children of which God hath given me. The captain of our salvation was made perfect. How? By suffering. That's what we read, didn't we? For him to sanctify me, he had to be made perfect. Jesus, a little lower than the angels. He, the God of the universe, a little lower than the angels, in the position of man, became the captain of our salvation so that he could sanctify us, but both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one. And what does he call them? Brethren. He's our older brother. He's the captain of our salvation. And we want to really understand this morning. Is your heart tuned? What did he say? As he was suffering as the captain of our salvation to be made perfect, what did he say? I will put my trust in him. In whom? In his Father. The factor that makes Jesus the Lord of the Sabbath is that the Sabbath is the sign of his work of sanctification in our life. It's connected with his own being made perfect. He passed through the process of sanctification. Notice the way he puts it in this wonderful high priestly prayer of John 17, where he is actually praying for us. John 17, verses 17 to 21, that prayer of relationship, that you may know that I am the Lord that sanctifies you. It is a sign of our relationship. John 17, reading there, verses 17 to 21. This is God, he's praying to the Father. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself. Sanctify them through the truth. The truth of me sanctifying myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone. He's not just praying for the 12. Who's he praying for? But for them also which shall believe on me through their word. Who does that include? Do you believe? He's praying for us now. What is he praying for? That they all may be one. As thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Are they not endearing words? Oh, how quickly they are read and not resonating in the soul. But as we are here in this divine service, we need to let them resonate in our being. And may the Holy Spirit draw very close to us, because we need to understand what these things are in living reality. He that sanctifieth is one with those whom he sanctified. And this is where our scripture reading comes into focus, which we read right in the beginning. Revelation 14:12. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God, among which was the Sabbath. And what else? The faith of Jesus. This is the title of our divine service today. The faith of Jesus. Here they are, the third angel's message people. They have the patience, they have the commandments of God, and they have the faith of Jesus. How did they get there? The commandments of God. They keep the commandments of God. What did those commandments of God do to them to get them to the faith of Jesus? Do you remember? Galatians 3, 23 to 26. Let's turn there again. How did they get there? Galatians chapter 3, verse 23 to 26. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterward be revealed. Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under the schoolmaster, for you are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. If you have faith in Christ Jesus, then the law is going to lead you along until you have the faith of Jesus, the schoolmaster. That's how they got there, via the schoolmaster. And if you just flip across to Galatians chapter 2, verse 19 and 20, there it is again. For I, through the law, am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. How did those people get there? How does he get there? Verse 20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live, how? By the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. So when finally this company of the third angel are standing there, they have been brought through the schoolmaster experience, and that's why it says they have patience. Are you impatient with your progress? The schoolmaster is required to lead me there. And then, having had the patience, they keep the commandments of God, and they have the faith of Jesus, because the schoolmaster led them there. This is what we need to comprehend here. These are all declarations which we can talk about, and it doesn't do much for you. This has been bandied around ever since 1888, and in all my life, this has been bandied about theologically. And I used to stand and watch the bandying of these beautiful statements, and I bled in my heart because the people were just discussing it, about it. They didn't understand and comprehend the living reality of it. Pray to God he will help us now. Because apparently in 1888, in the 1888 message, the light of this faith of Jesus was required. And I read it to you why this message was required. In Selected Messages, Book 3. Selected Messages, Book 3. I read there from page 172. Hear the very quote of our scripture reading. The third angel's message is the proclamation of the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. The commandments of God have been proclaimed, but the faith of Jesus Christ has not been proclaimed by the Seventh-day Adventists as of equal importance. The law and the gospel going hand in hand. I cannot find language to express this subject in its fullness. Didn't we have problems last night? Didn't we have problems even comprehending it? Sister White says, I cannot find language to express this subject in its fullness, the faith of Jesus. It is talked of, but not understood. What constitutes the faith of Jesus that belongs to the third angel's message? So it's talked of. It's theologically discussed. But what does it say? Not understood. What constitutes the faith of Jesus? Jesus becoming our sin bearer, that he might become our sin pardoning Savior.
He was treated as we deserve to be treated. He came to our world and took our sins that we might take his righteousness. And faith in the ability of Christ to save us amply and fully and entirely is the faith of Jesus. According to this inspiration, in the time of 1888, this was the condition of the Adventist Church. They did not understand the faith of Jesus. How do we stand today? Is it any better today? In fact, it's deteriorated. And so, this whole subject that I'm just reading here, quoting from, is actually in reference to what Sister White was writing back there in regards to Jones and Wagner's messages. Directly in reference to that. Just taking you up a paragraph. When I stated before my brethren that I had heard the first time the views of Elder E.J. Wagner, some did not believe me. The reason why they were having trouble was because she had already been speaking about this subject and they thought she got it from Wagner. And she said, I've only just heard him for the first time. And that's where this whole subject was aroused in that quote there. So let's now, in that what we've just been reading, what is the faith of Jesus that she described there? You know, you can read those words and still not comprehend them, can't you? It says, the faith of Jesus is Jesus becoming our sin bearer that he might become our sin pardoning Savior. He was treated as we deserve to be treated. He came to our world and took our sins that we might take his righteousness. And faith in the ability of Christ to save us amply and fully and entirely is the faith of Jesus. Well, if I just read that statement to you now, you say, oh, now I understand. Sorry. You don't. Unless you explore it. They're only words on a page. We need to go into the detail of these words and appreciate what they are actually trying to communicate. Enter with me into the amplification of these words, of the faith of Jesus as we read it there. Jesus became our sin bearer, became sin pardoning Savior. When we read he became our sin bearer, the automatic mental picture we're picking up is there he is, he's just been condemned for our sins. That's all we pick up on. We don't go any further in our natural thinking. In fact, when I raised this subject many times in the past, I was told this is only Jesus as our representative, that's all. It's a forensic exercise. And because people hold that view, they have missed the whole point. When Jesus took our sins, when Jesus was our sin bearer, what was his experience? Let's go there to 2 Corinthians 5:21. And let the scriptures unfold to our understanding what was
his experience, the living reality. Because remember, he was made perfect by suffering. He sanctified himself. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. Remember, he was made equal with us. Verse 21. For he, God, hath made him, Christ, to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Jesus became our sin bearer, remember, to become our sin pardoning Savior. Here it is, in this short statement. He hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin. Think about it. Here is a perfect person, perfectly pure, perfectly holy. He has never understood the experience of sinning. And now he is made to be sin, not just in terms of sinning, sin itself. What an experience do you think he had? If you come to 1 Peter chapter 2, 24, it says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree. What do you experience when something is in your body? If I, as a trained nurse, came to you and gave you an injection of a hallucinogen, hallucinating drug, I injected it into you, what will happen to you? You will hallucinate. Jesus was injected with sin. He was made to be sin, and it says our sin was in his body. What was his experience? May the Holy Spirit help us. Come to Lamentations, chapter 1. And he's plaintively crying out here, please, can you understand what I went through? I love this plaintive cry. He's yearning for us to understand what he went through. Is it nothing to you, all you that pass by? Behold and see if there be any sorrow like unto my sorrow. Can you comprehend, he says, what my sorrow is, which is done unto me? What was done unto him? Who did it? The Lord made him to be sin. Here it is. Wherewith the Lord hath afflicted me in the day of his fierce anger. From above hath he sent fire into my bones. Is there anybody here who's had an injection into their vessel, blood vessel? A drug injection into their blood vessel? You know the feeling? Fire into the bones. And it prevailed against them. I wasn't released from it. It sent fire through my system. He hath spread a net for my feet. He hath turned me back. He hath made me desolate. and faint all the day. The yoke of my transgressions is bound by his hand. They are wreathed and come up upon my neck. Have you ever had a heart attack? I've been pretty close to one. It chokes you. And when Jesus, we're going to read it in a moment, when Jesus was wreathed with my sin, with everybody's sin, an overdose, it choked him. He hath made my strength to fall. The Lord hath delivered me into their hands, from whom I am not able to rise up. Come to verse 16. For these things I weep. Mine eye runneth down with water, because the comforter that should relieve my soul is far from me. What did Jesus say? I will send you another comforter. Where was he now? Far from me. My children are desolate because the enemy prevailed. Can you explore his experience? Let's explore some more. Look upon Jesus. Gaze upon him until all your righteousness melts away. Psalm 22. Here is more of his experience when he was made to be sin. Psalm 22, 1 and 2. You'll recognize it immediately. How did he feel with when he was made to be sin? My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? O my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. You're not even hearing me. You're my God, and I'm not getting any answers from you. Have you ever felt like that? Have you cried to God and you don't get an answer? How long have people cried and they haven't got an answer until they understand what it's all about? Jesus had to show them the way out, and here he is in the deplorable condition of the veriest sinner. And he never sinned. Remember that. Can you imagine the contrasting agony? Because he was so pure, and yet he experienced the depravity of sin. He was made to be sin. If you come down to verse 14 of Psalm 22, I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. Have you ever had a melting sensation through your system? You know, when you're just sickening for a severe flu, you feel like all your bones are out of joint? Much worse than that. That's what Jesus experienced. And then in Psalm 69, his description of his experience. Psalm 69, verse 1 to 3. What's he doing? Lord, save me. Save me, O God, For the waters are come in unto my soul. I sink in deep mire where there is no standing. I am come into deep waters where the floods overflow me. I am weary of my crying. My throat is dried. Mine eyes fail while I wait for my God. Here is the patience of the saints. Wait. Jesus had to wait. And then we come to Psalms 40. And here it is, in horrifying reality. He says in verse 11 and 12, this is Jesus speaking. He says, I delight to do thy will in verse 8. I have preached righteousness in verse 9. And now verse 11. Withhold not thou thy tender mercies from me, O Lord. Let thy loving kindness and thy truth continually preserve me, for innumerable evils have compassed me about. Mine iniquities have taken hold upon me, so that I am not able to look up. They are more than the hairs of mine head, therefore my heart faileth me. My iniquities? Whose iniquities were they? Both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one. Therefore, he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Whose iniquities are they? Ours. And he was numbered among the transgressors, Isaiah 53. And I'm not able to look up. Do you know what it's like when you can't even look up because you're so depressed by absolute condemnation? And it was so bad that his heart failed. It ruptured, in fact. High blood pressure. Stress. Jesus met it all. And it comes from Signs of the Times, November 18, and also 25, 1889, a year after the 1888 message. The evil thoughts, the evil words of every son and daughter of Adam press upon his divine soul. What pressed upon him? Evil works, evil thoughts, and evil words were his, oppressing him. Though the guilt of sin was not his, although he hadn't committed this to do this, his spirit was torn and bruised by the transgression of men. If he drank of the cup of suffering, he must open his breast to the griefs and woes and sins of humanity. His heart inside of him received every detail of the horror of the human race. He was made not only forensically a sinner, but he was made to be a sinner. And mark my words carefully, because don't get strung up on them. He was made. He did not do these things. He was made to be sin, who knew no sin. So, remember the schoolmaster? What did we read in reference to the schoolmaster? What does it do to us, and what does it do with him right there? It kept on nagging. It kept on condemning. It kept on doing its work until we felt like a washed out rag. Right? How did Jesus feel? A washed out rag. He was so devastated that he saw no hope. Condemned with sin in all its dimensions in his body. What was the faith of Jesus now? Is there any faith left in that experience? Let's come to Luke chapter 23. Here is a little statement that is in harmony with what we read in Hebrews. I will put my trust in him. Luke chapter 23. As he was hanging on the cross, as he was going through this horror of what the schoolmaster has done to every sinner. Luke 23, verse 46. And when Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, that was what was recorded in Matthew, "My God, why hast thou forsaken me?" He cried out. He said, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. What did you just identify there? What did Jesus just do? I'm totally condemned. He just cried out, "My God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And what does he do next? I'm going to throw myself at your mercy. All condemned, all riddled with sin in his body, all affected like he wrote in Lamentations. And he says, "Here I go. I'm throwing myself at your mercy. Into your hand I commend my spirit. I can't live any longer." He gave up the ghost. I will put my trust in him. Let's read it in Psalm 69, verse 13 to 16. But as for me, my prayer is unto thee, O Lord, in an acceptable time. Mark those words, in an acceptable time. My prayer is unto thee, O God, in the multitude of thy mercy. Hear me in the truth of thy salvation. Deliver me out of the mire, and let me not sink. Let me be delivered from them that hate me, and out of the deep waters. Let not the water flood overflow me, neither let the deep swallow me up, and let not the pit shut her mouth upon me. Hear me, O God, O Lord, for what does he say now? For thy loving kindness is good. Turn unto me according to the multitude of thy tender mercies. What is he referring to here? He's referring to the God of the universe who has a heart that is described in Psalm 51, verse 17. Turn there with me. Psalm 51, verse 17. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. There was Jesus, made to be sin for us. The sin was so much part of him that he said, it's mine. And he cries to God under the sense of the condemnation of the schoolmaster. He cries to God, oh, I'm going through horrifying experience. Where are you, God? And what did Job's wife say to Job? That's what sinners think. It's too bad. Curse God and die. But what did Jesus do? He knew God. He knew that when a person is so wicked and so deplorably hopeless, where there is no excuse for sin, and he knows it, and he's absolutely condemned, and he goes to the Father and says, I know you. Your loving kindness is so good. Your multitude of mercies are so great that although I am condemned by my sin, I'm going to throw myself at your mercy, and you will not despise me. Tell me, do you ever despise somebody who has sinned against you? God doesn't do it. God does not do it. God's heart is compassionate for the veriest sinner who comes to him in brokenness of spirit. It says it here, doesn't it? He will not despise. And what did we read there? Faith in the ability of Christ to save us amply and fully and entirely is the faith of Jesus. What did Jesus do when he was me? He relied upon the Father and he believed the Father. Let me read it here beautifully in Desire of Ages. Page 756. Here he was. And here's the description in the beautiful amplification of the Spirit of Prophecy on page 756. Amid the awful darkness, apparently forsaken of God, Christ had drained the last dregs in the cup of human woe. The dregs. Have you ever experienced the dregs of your corruption? Jesus had every item of it. In those dreadful hours, he had relied upon the evidence of his Father's acceptance heretofore given him. He was acquainted with the character of his Father. What was the character of the Father? A broken spirit I cannot and will not despise. He understood his justice.
He understood his mercy and his great love. By faith, he rested in him whom it had ever been his joy to obey. And as in submission, he committed himself to God, the sense of the loss of the Father's favor was withdrawn. By faith, Christ was victor. Do you want the victory over sin? You must have the faith of Jesus. What did it do? When he was overwhelmed with total deprivation, the last dregs of human woe of sin, made to be sin, he remembered the character of his Father, that the sacrifice that is acceptable to God, remember, in an acceptable moment. There it is. What's the acceptable moment with God? When you are broken up over the condition of your sinfulness, that is the acceptable moment in which God's character cannot despise you. That is the Father's character. He cannot despise you. If you cry unto him in a broken condition, he cannot turn away from you. That's his nature. Don't you love him? If I wouldn't be... As soon as I stop to think about it, it overwhelms me. But I'm trying to share the word with you. I've got to control myself. What a father. And he demonstrated his love by putting his own son into the deprivation that you and I are in. And then he shows us, look, he suffered more than any of us with the deprivation of sin, and the Father didn't reject him. What's he going to do with you who hasn't suffered as much as him if you will break down before him? This is the faith of Jesus. As condemnation of the law drives you to distraction, it reveals Jesus who sanctified himself with you and his faith in action. And when his faith is part of you, then God's mercy will do for you what it did for him. Psalms 40, verses 1 to 4, there it is. Beautifully expressed and quickly read over and not understood. Remember, here is the patience of the saints. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay. Remember how he was praying, take me out of this mire, the waters overflowing me. What did the Father do as he threw himself upon him? He brought me out of a miry clay and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. He hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. What sort of a praise will come from that heart? Many shall see it. Now he's saying, look at me, everybody. Anyone who sees it and fears and shall trust in the Lord, blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust and respecteth not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. It's a lie when they say that Jesus was not in sinful flesh. It's a lie. those that turn aside to lies will become Pharisees. So what are you to do continually in your sinful flesh? What are we to do? 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 10. First Corinthians chapter 4. There in verse 10. I'm sorry, it's 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 10. What are we to do? Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. Jesus partook of my body. He partook of my sin in his body. Do you have your sin in your body? Sorry, you can't get rid of it. It's there in your body. But what are you to do? Always carrying in your body the dying of the Lord Jesus. The very thing I have just laid out before you. Day after day after day, die with Jesus. Die with Jesus. So that the power of God resurrecting you every day will be your experience. That is righteousness by faith. That is the 1888 message. What is the reality of dying every day? Every moment that a sense of your sinfulness and the consequences of your sinfulness oppress you, every moment that that comes to your conscience, doesn't that happen frequently? Then cast yourself upon God's mercy at that moment. Believe him as Jesus did. As soon as a condemnatory memory of your sin comes up in your mind, it's not presumption if you believe it was that the Father will take that away from you when you cry to him, Lord, here I go. There's my sin. Have mercy upon me, as Jesus cried. Every moment the thoughts come, die with Jesus. Die with Jesus. And the Lord will immediately restore you because he's done it in Jesus already. This is our need. Believe in Jesus so that you may have the faith of Jesus in action. And that is what the theme of our conference is. Walking in the light of 1888. That's what this is. Do that every moment. Do it every day, every moment. And God will do his part every day, every moment in raising you again. This is what is meant with the words of Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7 to 9. Hebrews 5, verse 7 to 9. Here he was in the days of his flesh, Jesus, when he had offered up prayers and supplication with strong crying and tears. Remember, my tears flow. Is it nothing to you, all you that pass by? He was crying there in the days of his flesh. What was he crying? With strong tears unto him that was able to save him from death and was heard in that
he feared. Who did he need to save him? The one you need to save you. When Jesus came to save us, he didn't come to save us in the sense that the Father comes to save us. He came to save us to show us how we can be saved. And how? To cry unto him as he did, so that the Father could save me and you in him. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. He was made holy by the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became what? The author of eternal salvation. Isn't that just what I said before? He will come to save us in a different way than the Father will save us. He came to save us by showing us the authorship. He wrote the book. He was the author of the salvation. And if we will follow his sanctifying, he said, I sanctify myself so that they might be sanctified through the truth of my sanctification. Being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. Thus, being the author of salvation, he is the author of our faith, the faith of Jesus, by which we can be saved. Come to Hebrews 12, and there it is. Hebrews 12, 1 to 3. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, all the universe is watching, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. What are we meant to be doing? To lay aside the sin that doth so easily beset us. Can you do it? You can't, but in the faith of Jesus you can. It says it, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down in the right hand of the throne of God. For, and I love this, consider him. That's what we're doing here. You need to do this every day. Consider this. Consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be wearied and faint in your minds. You have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. As Jesus? Ah. So what do you do with Jesus? Consider him. Take hold of his faith. And as you are taking hold of the author and finisher of the faith, it becomes our faith. And the righteousness that he gained becomes our righteousness. That's how it happens. But you've got to believe it. If you throw yourself into the battle of contradictory theological arguments, you'll never come to it. Only as you believe it does it become a reality. And so I want to summarize this message directly from the words of A.T. Jones. This is the summary, and it's from the 1895 sermons in the General Conference of 1895, 7 years after 1888. On page 270 of this book I'm reading from, the General Conference Bulletin of 1895, there on page 270 is the summary. the best way of summarizing what we have just studied. When he, Jesus, stood where we are, when he stood where we are, he said, I will put my trust in him. And that trust was never disappointed. In response to the thrusts, the Father dwelt with him, in him and with him, and kept him from sinning. Who was he? We. And thus the Lord Jesus has brought to every man in this world divine faith. That is the faith of the Lord Jesus. That is saving faith. Faith is not something that comes from ourselves, with which we believe upon him, but it is that something with which he believed, the faith which he exercised, which he brings to us, and which becomes ours and works in us, the gift of God. That is what the word means. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. They keep the faith of Jesus because it is that divine faith which Jesus exercised himself. He being we, brought to us that divine faith which saves the soul. That divine faith by which we can say with him, I will put my trust in him. And in so putting our trust in him, that trust today will never be disappointed any more than it was then. God responded then to the trust and dwelt with him. God will respond today to that trust in us and will dwell with us. God dwelt with him and he was ourselves. Therefore, his name is Emmanuel, God with us. Not God with him. God was with him before the world was. He could have remained there and not come here at all, and still God could have remained with him. And his name could have been God with him. He could have come into this world as he was in heaven, and his name could still have been God with him. But that never could have been God with us. But what was needed was God with us. God with him does not help us. Unless he is we. But that is the blessedness of it. He who was one of God became one of us. He who was God became we, in order that God with him should be God with us. Oh, that is his name. That is his name. Rejoice in that name forever. God with us. Amen.